Well, good morning and welcome to Valley Harvest Ministries Online. What a beautiful morning. Don't know about where you are, but in Shiloh this morning, it was a crisp morning with some frost on the windows, but it's going to be warming up nicely today. And what an opportunity the Lord has afforded us to experience His presence and His anointing together as we worship Him today and receive His Word. I'm so glad you came along. I want to also say Happy Mother's Day to all of our ladies. We honor you and we're thankful that God has placed you in our lives. Just before we get into a time of worship, I want to share a couple of things with you. First of all, if you know someone, and I'm sure you do, that needs to hear the Word of God this morning, would you just take a minute and share this link with them and encourage them to join us? And secondly, if you will, just take a minute and help us by commenting on the page so that our staff can count you present today. That's how we take the roll. And our online attendance has been great, and we rejoice with all of our out of town viewers as well. So I want to take just a minute and say that we are going to be able to open our doors next Sunday for corporate worship here on the hill. Do I hear an amen? Amen. Hey, all right. And if you are a regular attender here at Valley Harvest, you're going to be receiving a special video this week that will outline some guidelines for next, or at least for the next few Sundays. So look for that this week. And if you have been attending online, either locally or from a distance, you'll still be able to do that. We've come to know that our online church is growing, and we want you to know that we value you very much. We want to continue to reach out to you and to be able to hear from you. Lastly, I want to thank you for your financial support. At the end of the service today, our media team will place the stewardship slide up, and it will give you instructions as to how you can place your offering. God bless you today, and let's join in our worship team for a time of praise and worship.
Faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still. you ready to see Him do it again? Hallelujah. This is my testimony this morning.
We don't know what's going on, and we can't explain it, but God is faithful. The same God, He is faithful today, yesterday, today, and forever. And you need to stand on the Word of God this morning, whatever it is you're dealing with. After 4 years, we received the news that we were going to receive a miracle. And this morning when I woke up, that little miracle was laying peacefully in her bed. And I just want to praise God that for this Mother's Day, a year ago today, I announced this and gave my testimony. And every year, I want to give this testimony that God is faithful. And I am holding, every day, I hold the answers to my prayers. So don't give up, even though it may not make sense. don't give up. Whatever you need this morning, whether it be a healing, a deliverance, a lost child, whatever it is you're praying for, do not give up, because God is good and He is faithful. He said that He would turn our mourning into dancing. He would give us beauty for ashes, that sorrow may last for the night, but joy will come in the morning. And He said that He will wipe away every tear from our eyes. So whatever you have mourned for, whatever you are struggling with this morning, just put it in God's hands. He is a good, good Father. And hold on to faith this morning. Let's trust Him, church. Let's trust Him for whatever it is that we need. He is a faithful God. And I just want to declare His goodness this morning. For the rest of my life, every day that I live, I will praise Him for His goodness. Amen. Hallelujah.
I love You, Lord. Oh, Your mercy never fails me. Oh, my days have been held in Your hands. From the moment that I wake up till I lay my head, I will
goodness is running out. It's running out to me. Your goodness.
is your weapon this morning. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And if there's ever been a time, church, that we need to get in His presence, we need to proclaim the goodness of God and enter into His presence and lift Him up in this nation, Lord. We need to do that right now. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. His presence is a weapon this morning. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Come on.
tonight, church. We know who won the victory. Amen. Hallelujah. We are victorious in Jesus' name. Amen.
It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you.
Right there in your living room, wherever you're watching this. Surrounding you this morning. Hallelujah.
It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you.
Thank you, Jesus.
It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you.
Lord, you're a good father, and you are faithful. You're a faithful God. Keep holding on to his promises, church. He hasn't left us. He hasn't left us yet. He said, I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. He's the same God, and he's a good, good father. Hallelujah. Let's put our trust in him this morning. Keep declaring his goodness. Amen.
What a privilege it is for us to be able to fight our battles, knowing that that our God is with us and the battle is his. And it's already been declared. We are the winner. We are more than conquerors. We're overcomers through him. Hallelujah. Once again, I want to say happy Mother's Day. We're so glad that you are joining with us today for this service. And we look forward when we can see you here in person. And that time is, you know, it seemed like it was a long time coming, but it is here. Next Sunday, we can come together here, and it's going to be a great day. I hope that you can be a part of that. Are you ready to get into the Word today? I am ready to bring the Word today, a Word that I believe is very important for us to hear and receive in the face of the times that we are living in and things that we're dealing with. So we're going to read today. Unusual for me, most of the time I read out of the King James Version. So I'm saying that for the sake of anyone that might find it most unusual for me to read today from the NIV. I have read this passage several times in multiple translations. And the NIV just says it pretty plain. We're going to go to 2 Thessalonians today, the second chapter. If you want to turn in your Bible wherever you are, you may have a different translation. And, you know, it'd be interesting for you to compare as we go forward with that. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, we're going to read several verses here from the NIV. It says, concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our being gathered to him, we ask you, brothers, not to become easily unsettled or alarmed by some prophecy, report, or letter supposed to have come from us, saying that the day of the Lord has already come. Don't let anyone deceive you in that way. For that day will not come until the rebellion occurs and the man of lawlessness is revealed, the man doomed to destruction. He will oppose and will exalt himself over everything that is called God or is worshipped, so that he sets himself up in God's temple, proclaiming himself to be God. Don't you remember when I was with you, I used to tell you these things? And now you know what is holding him back, so that he may be revealed at the proper time. For the secret power of lawlessness is already at work, but the one who now holds it back will continue to do so till he is taken out of the way. And then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord Jesus will overthrow with the breath of his mouth and destroy by the splendor of his coming. The coming of the lawless one will be in accordance with the work of Satan, displayed in all kinds of counterfeit miracles, signs, and wonders, and in every sort of evil that deceives those who are perishing. They perish because they refuse to love the truth and be saved. For this reason, God sends them a powerful delusion so that they will believe the lie, and so that all will be condemned who have not believed the truth, but have delighted in wickedness. But we ought always to thank God for you, brothers, loved by the Lord, because from the beginning God chose you to be saved through the sanctifying work of the Spirit through belief in the truth. He called you to this through our gospel, that you might share in the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. So then, brothers, stand firm and hold to the teachings we passed on to you, whether by word of mouth or by letter. May our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loved us and by his grace gave us eternal encouragement and good hope, encourage your hearts and strengthen you in every good deed and word. Let's bow for a word of prayer. Father, thank you for your holy word. Thank you that it is alive and active. Thank you that it is on time and is anointed. Thank you, God, that it has the ability to pierce through everything and get to the heart of the matter. And I pray today, God, that you would cause it to do just that in the hearts and minds of every listener today. Lord, do your work. You sent this word for a specific reason, and your word declares that it will not return empty or void. So, Father, I claim that today, that lives are going to be touched and changed, and your will and your work will be done. In Jesus' name I pray, and all God's people said, amen. I titled today's message, In the Way. In the Way. I wonder if you've ever been in the way. You just were blocking something from happening. You understand what I mean by being in the way. That's what we're going to talk about today. I don't know of a more pertinent passage in the Bible than the one that we just read together. In the last 2 weeks, I don't know how many translations I have read this in, and I have also read after multiple commentators. I recommend that when you have the opportunity later today, or maybe in your morning devotions, if you have a parallel Bible, read this passage in several different translations. But I think the Christians in Thessalonica were likely experiencing some of the same thoughts and some of the fears that many in our day are experiencing. You know, the world and people that are unfamiliar with the Scripture have questions now, more questions perhaps than they've ever had about, you know, what does all of this mean that we are seeing and we are going through? What's it all mean? Believers that have heard the messages and read the Bible also have issues that relate to the times and current events. They are having a time relating the two, the current events and relating it to Scripture. And can I say it is very important that we do that. All of my life, I have heard that Jesus is coming soon. And I believe it today more than I've ever believed it in my life. Everything I know about the Bible and the witness of the Holy Spirit tells me that His coming is very nigh, and that we should be watching with a constant expectation of His appearing. I don't know about you, but I am currently living in a constant expectation of that event. I awaken every morning with the thought, well, we're still here. That means this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it, and I will see what God wants me to do today. Remember that one of the main themes of the first letter of Thessalonians spoke of the Lord's coming and the time of the great tribulation ending in the judgment of the world. There was apparently some confusion about that in the church at Thessalonica, because some feared and some were actually preaching and teaching that Jesus had already come and that they had missed it. Wouldn't that be a dreadful realization? I wonder if you've ever just pondered that thought of what it would be like to realize one day that the rapture had taken place and you were left with those that didn't believe here on the earth. I want to remind you that one of the main themes of the first letter to the Thessalonians spoke of the Lord's coming. As I said, they were being made to believe that he had already come. And if that was the case, their eschatology was all out of sync. And there was a great reason for them to be concerned. So Paul had to remind them of the teachings that he had previously been over with them. So with the current events, perhaps you too have had questions or thoughts about just where we stand in the timeline of end time events. With the way we have seen the acceleration of the signs, no doubt we've wondered, is it possible that we're already in the tribulation period? And if so, just how much of what we read about the tribulation period would we have to endure? So, with that introduction, I want to deal with some specific things addressed in our text. And I believe that God will give us revelation and understanding in this. There's three things that we're going to pull out in this passage. First of all, Jesus is coming. Jesus is coming. The rapture of the church is imminent. He said in John 14 to his followers, to you and I today, don't let your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe or trust also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again to receive you to myself, and where I am, there you may be also. 1 Thessalonians, the 4th chapter, says, for the Lord himself shall... Oh, let me back up and change the emphasis on that. He's not sending somebody. The Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. These words, the thought, the truth that Jesus is coming back soon is supposed to be a comforting thought that we share with one another. Thank God he's coming back for us, church. Peter says he's not slack, he's not careless concerning his promises. It says the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night. And over in the Word of God, it teaches that he's going to come as a thief in the night. And those that are ready for his coming, those that have believed and put their trust in the gospel, those that have been saved, those who are living for Him and looking for Him, the bride that has made herself ready will be caught up with the saints to meet the Lord in the air. And it says, so shall they ever be with the Lord in the air. That's 1 Thessalonians 4:17. Listen, church, don't you despair. God has not forgotten. He has not forsaken us. He's going to send His Son for us very soon. Those that are not prepared will be left here to face the worst of the worst times ever experienced in the history of the world. And eventually, they will face an eternity in hell. So if there was ever an urgency for people to hear and to respond to the message of the gospel, it is today. I'm going to say that again. If there has ever been an urgency, it's a time-dated opportunity for people to hear and respond to the gospel, it is today. Mark it down. Believe it in your heart. Jesus is coming soon, and His word says today is the day of salvation. Now is the time to get ready for that. So, the first point, the rapture of the church is a definite event that is going to happen anytime. The second point we're going to talk about from this, the scripture in verse 3 of our text speaks of a falling away. It speaks not only of the falling away, but it speaks of its cause, and it speaks of the result of that falling away. This is translated from two Greek words used in the passage. The first one is apostasia, and listen to its meaning in the original language. To defect from the truth. To defect or to forsake the truth. The other word is apostasion, meaning a divorcement. Webster further defines apostasy as a total desertion or departure from one's religion, principles, party, or cause. How many thinks that we've seen some of that in our world today? The greatest problem the world has today is that our world, our society, has abandoned God and has abandoned His word and has shoved them aside. Understand, the Antichrist, I'm talking about the false Christ, one that is empowered by Satan himself, is coming to set up his evil regime here on the earth. And through deception and ultimately force, he will exercise power over many and all that are taken by him, who will be doomed to an eternity in hell. Now, here's what God's word says in our passage of Scripture. He said that the spirit of Antichrist is already working. It is currently at work in the world around us. Look at verse 7. It says, for the secret power of lawlessness is already at work. The person of the Antichrist, the person, has not yet been revealed. But the evil spirit behind him is already working overtime in the world. The world is daily and progressively being conditioned to receive him when he is revealed without raising so much as an eyebrow. Let's look at what God's word says and what would be the MO of the Antichrist. Verse 4 says in our text, he will oppose and will exalt himself over everything that is called God or that is worshiped. He will oppose and exalt himself over everything that is called God or that is worshiped. Let me ask you, what are you seeing in the world today that rebels against everything we know to be true from the Word of God? Can I tell you that there is an all-out rebellion taking place in our society against every wholesome principle and value of truth shown forth in the Word of God? God said the rapture is going to take place, but he listed two things, the rebellion and the coming of the Antichrist as being a factor. If there is a rebellion taking place in our society, you've got to see it. I mean, if God says something is right, the spirit of this world proclaims the exact opposite. What is worse is that people are believing, they're being deceived, and they are believing and receiving the lie. Understand, the world around us is being conditioned to follow the wrong spirit, and if not corrected, they will eventually follow the Antichrist. Amen? You can see it. God opened the eyes of your people today to understand that what we're saying is true. It's revelation of what's taking place. Now, we want to go on a little bit further in this word. Here's where it really gets serious. The Word of God that we read tells us that it is not only people that have never heard the gospel that are being deceived. You know, I don't know about you, but I can understand how it is a simple thing for the devil to deceive people that don't know anything about God or don't know anything about His Word. They haven't been exposed. They don't have revelation into the will of God and to His holy Word. But what is really concerning is that there are people that have heard the Word. They have heard the gospel, and yet they are being deceived. The real danger is with the people who have heard the gospel and rejected it. They are the ones in the greatest danger of being misled and deceived by the Antichrist. Oh, that puts a whole new spin on things, because there are a lot of people that are living today and say, oh yeah, I grew up in church. I've heard that preaching. I know that scripture. I know pretty much what it says there. And they're feeling, well, I'm more secure than somebody that has never heard. But God says that the people that have heard the word and failed to accept it, but rather have rejected it, are in more danger of being deceived and misled than someone that's never heard it. The second chapter of Hebrews says, how shall we escape if we neglect such great salvation? Let's look back at our text, beginning with verse 9. It says, the coming of the lawless one will be in accordance with the work of Satan, displayed in all kinds of counterfeit miracles, signs, and wonders, and in every sort of evil that deceives those who are perishing. Now watch this. They perish because they refuse to love the truth and to be saved. For this reason, God sends them a powerful delusion so that they will believe the lie, and so that all will be condemned who have not believed the truth, but have delighted in wickedness. Friends, it is imperative that you know and that you believe the truth. God says for us to buy the truth and sell it not. Knowing the truth and continuing in the truth is what makes you free, Jesus said. The world around us is on a slippery slope that is getting worse every day as people are being led as sheep to the slaughter by the spirit of Antichrist, working to deceive and to convince them of the lies of the devil. Once the church, we're talking about the rapture now, once the church has been taken out of the world, the Antichrist will set up his kingdom on the earth, and his full evil will be exposed. Can you imagine the debut of an evil, a pure form of evil, even than what we have seen? Probably like me, you're wondering, I don't know how much worse it can get. I mean, I don't know how much more it can resemble the times in which God broke forth in judgment against the wickedness on the earth. What is it, though, that is keeping the Antichrist from coming into full revelation in his person and his kingdom right now? God said in this passage, and this is the last thing we're going to talk about from this passage, God says, there's something in the way. There is something holding him back. There is something that is restraining the Antichrist, something that is restraining the devil from having his full sway even as we speak. God said that he has left something in the world to withhold the will of this evil one. Verse 6, and now you know what is holding him back so that he may be revealed at the proper time. For the secret power of lawlessness is already at work, but the one who now holds it back will continue to do so till he is taken out of the way. He is talking about the power of the Holy Spirit operating in the church today. When he talks about that power and that withholding force being taken out of the way, he is talking about the rapture of the church. Folks, we must realize what a vital role we are playing in the scope of everything that is going on in the world today. We cannot be naive. We cannot be careless about our placement and our assignment. I want you to think about it just a little bit. In the scope of eternity and everything, the timeline of eternity, God has chosen to place you and I, the believers, the church of the Lord Jesus Christ, he has placed us at this time for such a time as this. He has left the church here until he takes her out of the picture. Now, I want to conclude by talking about the church a little bit. God's word declares that we are the salt of the earth. We are the preserving factor in our society. Oh, church, please, please understand. Please hear. Please let these words have the impact on your heart and your spirit that God wants it to have. You are the salt of the earth. How many of you know that God has always, always, always had a remnant that has not bowed their knee and has not sold out to the world, but stand firm and proclaim the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ, realizing that it is the power of God to the salvation of the Jew first and also to the Greek. I said, God has a remnant, and He is still at work through this remnant to accomplish His plan in the earth. The church is the light of the world that God has lifted up in these dark days and set on the lampstand so that all might see. The church is the rock that stands firm amidst the storms and the sinking sand that's all around us. The church has been given the keys of the kingdom and the authority on earth to bind and to loose. And God says, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. The church is the rock. The church has been given the mighty word of God and the power to decree and to declare a thing. The church has been given the authority of the name of Jesus. The church has been given the power of the person of the Holy Spirit working within its midst to convince of sin, of righteousness, and of judgment. The church is the entity that can touch heaven and touch earth at the same time with its power of intercession. It is through the church that our God has legal entrance to move and to work in the earth through the covenant workings that He has with us. It is the church that is the standard that God raises up when the enemy comes in like a flood. It is the church that has been established by God as the pillar of truth. And it has been commissioned to proclaim the soul-saving message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Folks, what is stopping the devil from revealing the Antichrist at this very moment and sealing the destiny of the remaining population of the world? It is the church of the Lord Jesus Christ under the anointing of the Holy Ghost that moves and dwells within her. It is the church operating under the mantle of the Holy Ghost. I'm going to say it again. It is the church operating under the mantle of the Holy Ghost. I want those words to resonate with you this morning. They have to become our vision. They have to become our motivation in these last and evil days. We are the church, anointed, filled, serving, operating under the mantle of the Holy Ghost. God is calling His church today to rise up in power and authority by the power of the Spirit that dwells within her. We must proclaim the truth. We must hold forth the blood-stained banner of the cross, and we must point people to Jesus. He has placed us in the way. He has charged us to hold back the powers of darkness until He comes. He has called us in the last day's harvest. He's called us to this mighty last day's harvest that is ripe in the fields and must be harvested in these days. The days are few. The days are short. The harvest is precious. The souls are eternal. And in God's great plan, He set us, the church, in the way. The spirit of Antichrist is working, but it can't have his full way because we're in the way. The devil wants to reveal the Antichrist and unleash his full plan against the people of the earth. But he can't do it because God has placed us in the way. And he says, I'm going to leave you in the way until I come and take you out of the way. Church, we've got to make sure that we're not just here, but we are in the way. We're not just a candle, but we're a candle that God has not put under a bushel, but he set it on a lampstand so that people might be drawn to the light. He said if we would lift up Jesus Christ, he will draw all men unto him. Jesus is the way. He is the truth. He is the life. So as we come to a close today, I must leave you with a couple of questions for you and the Holy Spirit to work through. The first very important question is, have you accepted the truth of the gospel? Have you accepted the truth of the gospel? Understand, it is very, very serious business if you've heard the truth, but you have opted to reject it. Because God honors your choice. He will honor your choice. If you prefer a lie instead of the truth, he will allow you to believe the lie. But if you value the truth, he will save you, and he will keep you safe in the darkest of times that the evil spirit of Antichrist can send on this earth. He will never leave you nor forsake you until he comes and gets you, if you accept the truth. If you accept the gospel, that very simply says, we're all sinners. We cannot save ourselves. We can't turn over enough new leaves. We can't have enough start overs on our own. It takes the mercy and the grace of a loving Savior that loved you enough to leave heaven and come to this sin-sick world where he lived the perfect example life with never committing a sin, but yet he surrendered to a death on a cross that you deserved. But he loved you enough that he took that punishment in your place, so that he could give you his right standing with the Father God. That's essentially the message of the gospel. It's a free gift. You cannot earn it or deserve it, but you can humbly accept it. You can bow your head, knowing that God is looking at your heart and listening to your words. And you can simply say, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I'm sorry for my sins. I turn from my sins and I turn unto you. Come into my heart today. I trust you to be my Savior. If you'll do that, He said that He will not turn you away. He said, whoever calls on His name, whoever calls on His name shall be saved. Have you done that? You can't afford to wait any longer. Surely, with the events of this world right now, surely, with the way the Holy Spirit and His Word is working, you must be convinced that there's an urgency about this. I want to encourage you, take the step today when we pray and accept God's free gift of salvation. To the church, to those that are already believers, I've got to ask you this question. Have you taken seriously the fact that God has placed you to stand in the way? One of my favorite mentors and fathers in the faith said something that has resonated and stuck with me. He said, the job of Valley Harvest Ministries is to make it hard for anybody to go to hell from Dublin, Virginia. Church, that's our assignment. God has set us down in the way. He has placed us between people and eternity. He has put us between the power of darkness and them, to show them the way. Have you accepted that role? When you see people that are obviously deceived and being ushered like sheep to the slaughter, do you have the burden? Are you acting on the calling of God to get in the way? In these final days, are you doing everything in God's power within you to advance the kingdom of God? Folks, when we get up every day and realize that we're still here, He didn't come get us yet. He's left us here. He's not done with us. There's a work for us to do. Then our motivation and our mindset must be, what can I do today to advance the kingdom of God? He has left us in the way. And He is saying, my people, it is time for you to rise up and take your place. Because this is the last, this is the final, this is the eternal cause that you have a role to play in. So if you're not in the way, I urge you, get in the way today. Would you bow your heads with me? Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Wherever you are, the most important part of this whole service is right now. Because you have a response. You have a decision. You have an opportunity. Right now, you're going to say yes or no to what God has spoken to you. And you know to be true. Don't reject the truth. Believe the truth. Let's pray. Father, we come to you today In the mighty name of Jesus, we're thankful, God, that we have today. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will be glad and rejoice in it. I will recognize that God has allowed me to live today because He has a divine calling and a divine purpose to fulfill in and through me this day. Heavenly Father, right now, I humbly bow before You and I surrender to that call and to that cause. Lord, I pray today that Your church has heard the word today and has heard You say it's time to stand up. It's time to take seriously our role in the earth today. Father, we rise up by faith today to be the light of the world, the salt of the earth. Lord, mantle us today with a fresh new anointing. A fresh new anointing, Lord. Let that mantle rest upon Your church today, that we might proclaim the truth of Your gospel. That Your Holy Spirit, as it did with the early church, might work with us with signs and wonders following. Lord, I pray that You would use us to win souls for You, Lord, and would turn people from the lies to the truth of the gospel. Lord, for anyone that has watched this service today and has heard the word, Lord, there's been a sobering effect to Your word today. For anyone that has heard the word and has taken it lightly and has rejected Your word, I pray, God, today that You call them back in alignment with Your word. I pray, God, for anyone that has heard this word that is not prepared for the rapture to take place. If they know today, if the trumpet sounded right now, and You called us up, if they know they would not be prepared for that, Lord, help them today. You said today is the day of salvation. Let it be their day. Help them to realize that You are calling, and all they have to do is to call out to You, to call Your name, to ask for Your mercy and grace, to trust You completely and to receive Your free gift of eternal life. Lord, help us to value highly the days that we have until You come and to make full proof of the ministry, Lord. Help us to redeem the time because the days are surely evil. We thank You for hearing our prayer today. We thank You for dealing with our hearts and for bringing us closer to Your perfect will. We give You praise and we give You thanks for it. In Jesus' name, and God's people said, amen. It has been a joy worshiping with You. Thank You for letting us come into Your home, Your car, Your office, Your workplace, wherever you have viewed the telecast today. We look forward to seeing you next time. God bless you. Happy Mother's Day.